once again trying a different beer with my experiments today. This is Corsair Brown Ale from Corsair Brewing in Quebec. Interesting that an English brown ale would be a style brewed in Quebec, but there we go. That's kind of interesting. I wasn't expecting it to be as malty-tasting as it is, because it's not a perfectly dark beer, but it's very nice. Nice roasty, malty, bit of chocolate notes. The usual kind of thing that I like to see in a beer. Okay. So today, as I often do, I'm playing with blinking LEDs. You'll see that there's only three outputs coming from that little board, and I'm controlling six LEDs with it. I know some of you that are experienced in this are going to be shouting, "Charlieplexing, Charlieplexing," and that's exactly what it is. It's a really useful technique if you want to get a whole bunch of outputs from a small number of control pins on your Arduino. Why would you want to do that? Well, possibly because you are using most of the pins for other things and you don't have that many left. Or perhaps you're using a smaller chip, a smaller microcontroller that doesn't have that many pins anyway. Something like these little DigiSpark boards, which are based on the ATtiny85. It's an 8-pin chip. You can see it right there. And in this case, you can see that I am controlling a dozen LEDs off that 8-pin chip. Except for I'm only using four of its pins. Count the resistors there. So, it's a pretty cool little technique, and it's not one that I'd played with before. This is something that was come up with apparently in the mid-90s by a guy named Charlie, who was working at one of the chip companies. And it showed up in an application note for a microcontroller that they were working on. It's just there. That makes it easier to see. So, let me just bop over to Wikipedia so that I don't have to do as much drawing. And I'll just show you how this kind of works out, because it's pretty cool. So the basics of it are that the LEDs are set up in pairs, and they're in reverse parallel like this. So if you got positive up here and negative down here, then this one's going to light. And if you flip it around, then this one's going to light. That's the basics. So if you move up in the count of LEDs, like this example here, which is essentially what I've got on that first breadboard with six LEDs, between pins 1 and 2, you've got this pair. So if you take that one high and that one low, this guy is lit, and vice versa. But then with the other sets, between these two, if you take this one high and this one low, then this guy's going to light up. Or if this one's high and that one's low, this one's going to light up. Or if one is high and three is low, then this one's going to light up. Where it gets weird and where the special case comes in here is they've all got to be in a state, right? So if one is high and two is high and three is low, then this one's going to light, but so is this one. You may or may not want that. You might want that, and that's perfectly valid. But if you don't, you have to use something which is called tri-state logic. Essentially, with that pin electrically disconnected in the circuit, so you can't pull any current through it. So if you put X1 high and X2 was floating, then there couldn't be current flow from here through this LED because there's no path, right? The trick is to put the one that you don't want to pull any current to reassign it as an input. That way no current can be drawn through it because it's not connected either to the high or to the low. It's just a high impedance input, basically. And so here is, since I'm here anyway, here's the code that I grabbed from this instructables up here, which I'll link in the description. So we set up, we defined the pins against the LEDs. the original one is using 11, 12, and 13. I decided to use 10, 11, and 12 just so that I wouldn't use 13 because it's already got the built-in LED on it. And I didn't want that drawing any extra current. So in the setup, there's nothing. There's just these three constants. And then in the loop, this just bangs through a bunch of different possible states. So for the first LED, we turn pin LED number one pin, which is 12. Tell it it's an output and set it low. We set the LED 2 pin, pin 11, as an output and put it high. So there's going to be 5 volts on that LED 2 and ground essentially on the LED 1. So the diode or the LED that's in that direction is going to light. But then the LED 3 pin, pin 10 in this case, gets set to an input. When you set the pin to an input, there's a 100 meg resistance in there, so you're not going to get any enough current through that to light up an LED or do anything useful. You can set it to input pull up, which puts a 20k to the high, to the power rail, but there is no pull down. So if you've forced it, if you called it an input and forced it low, then there's basically 100 meg between the pin and ground, which is not going to have any impact in this circuit. Okay, so back at the code after that little tangent, we have a low on 12, a high on 11, and an incredibly high impedance to ground on pin 10. So we only have one LED lit. Then we wait a second, and we change it. We set LED pin 1 to an output. It already is, but whatever, it's takes the command anyway, because this is just a copy paste a whole bunch of times and change the values in it. This time you set it high and you set the LED 2 pin low, so that means that its partner LED now turns on and it and the first LED turns off, and then just bang through all the way around, all the way through here. In the third step of the code, pin 1 become or LED 1 pin becomes the input, and then 2 and 3 become the two outputs, high and low, and on, and it just keeps going on that little pattern. Pretty straightforward once you get your head around it. Now then, you can use this method for huge numbers of LEDs with relatively small amounts of pins, and it escalates pretty rapidly here. For 4 pins, you can have 12 LEDs using 4 outputs of that ATtiny85. That ATtiny85 has 6 I/O pins that you can use, so I could theoretically drive up to 30 LEDs, but I just didn't want to build that on a breadboard for this demonstration, but that would be easy. Or on a standard Arduino, it's got 13 digital pins. So another question that I get quite frequently when I do a project or something that's blinking LEDs is, well, that's all well and good, but what use is blinking LEDs and turning LEDs on and off? Well, let me show you. So here we have another DigiSpark with exactly the same code on it as this one, which is the same piece of code that I showed you in the first place. Except for I'm controlling much higher power LEDs than the ATtiny microcontroller can possibly sync. I think one of these is, yeah, we're almost at 100 milliamps on one of these. So, and that would blow up the microcontroller. So instead of having the Charlieplexing driving the LEDs directly, it is connected up to these little chips here. These are optocouplers, sometimes called optoisolators. And basically, they are an LED and a phototransistor pointed at each other inside a package in the dark, so that when you light up the LED, the phototransistor turns on. Here's the optocoupler that I'm using. It's a 4N26. Yes, it's a very old-fashioned one. I happen to have some kicking around. As I was mentioning, there's an LED inside there and a phototransistor. You shine light from the LED on what is effectively the base connection, and it turns that little NPN transistor on. So there is absolutely no connection, no physical or electrical connection between the input side and the output side, which means you can put anything you please on the output side here as long as it respects that transistor. And in this case, the collector emitter breakdown voltage is 70 volts. So anything under 70 volts is fair game on there. And 100 milliamps in the collector. So in this case, the first two optocouplers are just driving these LEDs directly off that NPN transistor. So that's what, 20 milliamps, probably a bit less. No strain. Those I could have driven straight from here. But then over here for the third and fourth optocouplers, I have them, their NPN transistor on the output, driving a separate transistor which has a higher current carrying capability. These are just generic little 2 and 2222 transistors, so they're good for a couple hundred milliamps, which is more than enough for what I'm doing right here, but you could use literally any transistor in that spot as long as it's rated to handle your load. I tried a few other methods just tinkering around here earlier before I turned the camera on, using combinations of NPN and PNP transistors and various balances of resistors, and I couldn't quite get it to work directly like that, but that doesn't really matter because this is such a slick little solution. And I'm not sure, I probably didn't invent this, I'm sure I didn't invent this, but I hadn't seen anybody else using it before, so I just thought it was a cool way of expanding the capability. And as I said, with Charlieplexing, with this one with six outputs, you get up to, what, 20 different things being controlled by it? Which could be a pretty interesting way of going about it. Now then, if you're going to be pulsing it to have multiple things on at once, you probably don't want to have motor controllers on there. But if you're controlling lights of any kind, including, okay, yeah, there's other kinds of opto-isolators that you could use. I don't happen to have any handy, but there are some that have a triac output, which are designed to drive a larger external triac, which is basically designed for doing AC line level loads. So you could do large high power lighting loads with a triac output. So I know this isn't a new technique. Like I said, it's originally from the 90s. It's not as old as the dawn of time, like the classic 555 and 4017. Yeah, this guy is essentially doing the same job as that one. It's only capable of turning one on at a time, because that's the limit of the 4017. The 4017's outputs it can sink a little bit more current, but you know, maybe 20 or 30 milliamps, not a huge amount. This solution uses a few more components. Granted, though, it has no programming on it. It's super simple. It's as old as the hills compared to this. But, yeah, it's the same thing can be said there, though. If you can turn on an LED, you can turn on an optocoupler, which means you can turn anything on. So, I don't know. I know this isn't earth-shattering or anything, but it's just something that I was having fun playing with and tinkering with, so I figured I'd toss the camera on and I guess show you what I'm up to. Thanks for watching. Questions and comments down below as usual. I'll talk to you later. Be good to each other, huh? Cheers.